Detroit, a city on the road to recovery. As the downtown and midtown areas thrive, the focus turns to the city's neighborhoods. How to attract new businesses and residents, engage the existing community, and maintain a cultural identity. It's a tall order. A look at the challenges and the progress. MiWeek is live tonight for our special coverage of Detroit neighborhoods.
From the moment you wake up till you turn out the light, Masco is proud to be part of your everyday life. When you turn on the faucet for a cool drink of water, open a kitchen cabinet to set the family table, or freshen up a room with a new coat of paint, you do it all with Masco products. Masco and its family of companies, serving Michigan communities since 1929.
Did you know? Gordon Food Service was started by a 23-year-old entrepreneur as a butter and egg delivery business more than a century ago. In 1948, school teacher Gerard Wendell Hayworth borrowed $10,000 from his parents to start a woodworking operation in his family's garage. It's now Hayworth Incorporated. These are just some of the ways Michigan's pioneers started out as small companies with big ideas.
We are business leaders for Michigan. We are committed to making Michigan a top 10 state for jobs, personal income, and a healthy economy. Funding is also provided by Delta.
Thanks so much for joining us. I'm Christy McDonald. We are live and we are on the road tonight in Detroit for a special hour-long show talking about neighborhoods in the city. We're at the University of Detroit Mercy campus on Livernois and 6 Mile in Detroit, and a lot of our conversation will focus on the surrounding neighborhood. We'll talk with the people who have a stake in this community, residents, business owners, and city planners. Plus, we'll look at whether the growth that has happened here can be replicated in other parts of the city. We have an audience with us tonight. They will get a chance to get in on the discussion as well. And make sure you tell us what you think on Twitter and on Facebook during the show at MiWeek. We'd love to hear from you. So let's get started with our MiWeek contributors, Nolan Finley of the Detroit News and Stephen Henderson of the Detroit Free Press. Guys, it's good to see you. We're on the road tonight and live, huh?
It's good to be live.
I know. Anything could happen over the next hour. You know, I love it because so much we talk on the show about revitalization of Detroit, and we focus a lot on development in downtown, and we talk about how Midtown is really roaring forward. And then we say, well, there's got to be more focus on the neighborhoods. So, Nolan, let me start with you. When we say there's got to be more focus on the neighborhoods, what exactly does that really mean?
You know, Christy, I was out Monday night with a slow roll group, a bunch of bicyclists who ride Detroit every Monday. We rode all over the east side of Detroit. And when you're looking at this elephant of abandonment spread out on the table in front of you, you feel like you're sitting there with a plastic knife and fork. There really is a major challenge in the neighborhoods. There's been deindustrialization, abandonment, folks moving out, and it is a massive undertaking ahead of this city. And it does help you understand that you've got to do it small neighborhood at a time, like this 6 Mile Livernois neighborhood. It's important to stabilize pieces and not get overwhelmed by the massive undertaking ahead of us as a city.
You know, it's interesting to also point out, though, Stephen, that might work for one area might not work for another area in the city when you talk about the revitalization.
Yeah, well, and that's why you got to get the people in the neighborhoods involved in deciding for themselves what's next, what can work on my block, what can we do about the abandoned houses or the empty lots. And it's also incumbent on the city to invest in those people. It's not just about neighborhoods and structures, it's about individuals and trying to get them to the place where they can make some of these decisions for themselves.
And so the decisions aren't being made in a vacuum or being made in some small room somewhere with a chart and a graph and saying, all right, that's the plan and we're now going to take it and try to implement it there.
And you can see the strategy, you can see that how that would work in a neighborhood where there is a critical mass still. But in those neighborhoods that have just been completely left behind and you have one or two houses on a block, the strategy for those neighborhoods, I don't think we've got our handle on yet.
All right, well, we're going to be talking about a lot over this next hour. You know, we're in Detroit Mercy School of Architecture tonight, and our first guest is a man who is taking a lead in revitalizing the Livernois-McNichols corridor, and he's our host for this evening. Please welcome the president of the University of Detroit Mercy, Dr. Antoine Garibaldi. It's good to see you. Dr. Garibaldi, welcome to MiWeek, and thanks so much for having us here tonight.
Well, thanks for being here. We appreciate it very much.
All right, as we start this conversation about neighborhoods, and specifically the neighborhood that Detroit Mercy is in, talk about how the neighborhood has changed over the last 4 or 5 years.
Well, a good deal has changed in part because of a lot of collaboration. Certainly when I came about 5 years ago, when you walked up and down Livernois, a good number of lights were out. The streets really did not look as clean as they do today. The median didn't look as good as it looks today. And if you got off the Lodge Freeway and came down Livernois, you saw a lot of vacant and abandoned buildings and also some businesses. Today, those lights have been replaced with new lights, new poles. There are a lot of new businesses that are also cropping up along the street. And I would say that there's a revitalized sense in the neighborhoods. There are easily 7 to 8 different homeowners association where people have become very, very involved. And we've been very, very fortunate to have the support of the city and also the support of foundations, notably the Kresge Foundation.
So talk a little bit about the Live6 Alliance and the partnership with the Kresge Foundation, the DEGC, and what's happening here.
Well, sure. The DEGC and also Kresge Foundation were very, very critical in the Live6 Alliance becoming what it is today. A lot of our work were kind of individual projects. We were addressing lighting issues. We were addressing the median issues. We were working along with people, block captains, and also residents in the neighborhood. Live6 is providing some structure and some focus to it. So we've identified 4 key goals, and those goals are placemaking, neighborhood stabilization, business attraction and retention, and then a focus on safety and security. So we have support for the first 2 years of the grant, about $700,000. Support from Kresge, a couple of other organizations, and then the university is also involved too. But I see that as really a conduit. You know, we are a part of the facilitators. We're not the only one. We're one of many partners involved in this. So it gives people an opportunity who have a stake in this neighborhood the chance to say, I think that this is a real priority. Let's see how we can accomplish this together.
You're an urban university, but not a downtown campus. How do you engage your students, get them excited about this neighborhood? Are they living in this area? Are they doing business? Are there entertainment spots that you would typically associate with a campus?
Well, we're fortunate in that this is one of our 3 campuses. So mm-hmm. The law school is downtown, and also the dental school is over in Corktown. But our students do a lot of service all across the city, as well as through other areas around the country. But students want to come to the university because they want to be involved. They want to be engaged. Certainly, that's one of the reasons why our applications are up to 5,000 this year. That's easily a 10% increase from the previous year. They want to be involved and they want to work. So whether it's the neighborhood nearby or whether it's downtown, they pretty much pick out those kinds of areas that they would like to focus their attention on.
Mm-hmm. When you think about the Livernois 6 Mile corridor, you're talking about a lot of different neighborhoods, and there's a really wide range in terms of their level of stability. Some of them are really in good shape already, others have lagged behind. Talk about sort of trying to bridge that gap.
Well, that's one of the first things that I did when I came, is really spend some time talking with people in the neighborhood. So if I look to the south of the campus, Martin Park and Puritan, that area is nowhere near as good as University District is, or Sherwood Forest, or the Fitzgerald neighborhood. In working along with individuals, we've talked about some of the things that they consider to be a priority. Our students in our Master of Community Development program in the School of Architecture have also done a good number of studies talking to the neighbors and also some of the people who would like to own and establish businesses here. So by doing that, we're at least able to get a sense of what's really very, very important. So those goals I talked about of neighborhood stabilization, business attraction, retention, and also focus on safety and security, those goals really came from the residents of this area. They said those things were important if we're going to get other people to move into the neighborhood, get rid of the vacant and abandoned buildings, and also make their properties much more valuable than they are today.
What are the potential pitfalls, though, of dealing with this work and making sure that you do hear from the community, but there are, you're not gonna make everybody happy with what your plans are? What are some of the things that you see that you're watching out for?
Well, I would say that we don't ever expect everyone to agree. We have an understanding that we can agree to disagree. We certainly wanna make sure that everybody has some of the basic services that others do. I mean, one of the problems that we have, for example, is we focused on the Lodge Freeway to 6 Mile because 6 Mile to 8 Mile had already been focused on by the Urban Land Institute. So no one was really looking at this particular area. So one of the areas, for example, that so many of the neighbors really talk about are the vacant and abandoned homes. I mean, we have homes just to the south of our campus that have been there for a while. Unfortunately, people actually pay taxes on them. But trying to get those buildings demolished will take a little time. So by getting a lot of different people together and trying to address those issues with the bureaucracy, I think that that's really one of the pitfalls. And it's very easy for everyone to get frustrated because things don't happen as quickly. You know, we can applaud Live6 Alliance starting now, but it's taken 4 long years before we could actually get to that particular point.
And Nolan, you have a last question?
Well, I just wondered, your students, your student base, how heavily does it come from the city of Detroit? How invested are city kids in the University of Detroit?
Well, 80 to 85% of our students come from the state of Michigan. Mm-hmm. We are working very, very diligently on increasing numbers of our students from the immediate area. We have a very special project with the Detroit Public Schools. We've been doing that much, much more aggressively. But the reality is that there are a lot of students who live in the city of Detroit who go to school outside of the city of Detroit, whether it's a charter school or whether it's some of the suburban school districts. So we are making the campus feel like it is really a part of them. We only can house 900 students on this campus now, but there are some potential projects that are going to be up and running within the next year and a half that will allow for us to have more on-campus housing for upperclassmen. And that's going to be a really big help. So we've been here since 1877, on this campus since 1925. So we are not planning to go anyplace, and we just think it's a great time for us to really become even more invested in the city and particularly this neighborhood.
All right, Dr. Garibaldi, thank you so much for joining us. We appreciate it. You know, the neighborhood surrounding Detroit Mercy has long been a popular location for entrepreneurs. Now, over the years, businesses have come and they've gone, but many have stayed for decades, just like the people living in this historic community. And now, as the city rebounds from bankruptcy, the push is on to attract and to retain new businesses along a 2-mile stretch of Livernois Avenue. Take a look.
It's really important to me personally that the area comes back. A lot of my friends that are native Detroiters, we remember growing up there, storefronts being occupied, and you kind of knew the people that owned the business, and there are places that you utilized a lot. But then, I don't know, something happened, you turned around, and you're like, wait, when did all those get vacant?
I decided, why not make these sessions public?
Words like revitalization get thrown around a lot, and I think what pops into people's head is like the big foundation coming in to make the change happen. But really, the revitalization happens from within. It's about the people that are already there, the ideas that are already there, the culture that's already there.
And revitalization can happen one small business at a time. Meet Rhonda Morris, single mother, native Detroiter, and for the past 6 years, the proud store owner of Lucky's Cheesecakes just off Livernois and 6 Mile. Before the success of Lucky's Cheesecakes, Rhonda worked multiple jobs to make ends meet and pay for her daughter's education.
All while the time I was working, I was constantly saying, I want to open up a business. I cannot do this for the rest of my life. I don't want to work for other people. I appreciate the job that I had, but I just always wanted to have my own.
But an infection resulting from an injury stopped her from being able to work, leaving her to wonder how she and Lucky, at the time just a teenager, would make it.
So I came home to Lucky and I said, I don't know what we're gonna do. And she said, Mommy, I'm gonna come up with something.
I never thought that cheesecake would be the solution to anything.
She started cooking. And she started making cheesecakes.
A family friend said that the cheesecake was so good that I should sell it. And, you know, that just sparked an idea in my mind. And I started making cakes from home in our little kitchen.
Someone tasted our cheesecake, we don't know who, and called Channel 2 News.
From there, we received, like, once that piece was shown, tons of calls.
I was so excited. I was like, Lucky, I think we're gonna be okay. And we just kept making cheesecakes and I kept working.
She worked 3 jobs to do this. The business has grown immensely. It's grown so much that it's crazy that my mom is able to support our family, you know, with just the business. I've been able to go to school off of the business, you know? So it's incredible to me.
Just down the street from Rhonda's store, Detroit Sip is set to open soon. The cafe is the creation of longtime resident Giovanna Watson. At the moment, Detroit Sip sits between 2 vacant storefronts. As Giovanna sees it, her cafe is a diamond in the rough.
Conference room, and then we're gonna do the seating area over here. My first trip to McNichols for 6 Mile, I'll call it, as a business owner, it wasn't a good one. I saw broken glass, just blight, abandoned buildings. And I've been asked multiple times, why here? What do you see here? And now I see potential. I see an opportunity to recreate or to write our own story.
A story that includes local businesses helping each other grow.
What's unfortunate is a lot of people only think that big developments make a neighborhood, but in a neighborhood like this, that where the community's so tight and the geography's actually small, like one little business could mean so much.
I believe that one business at a time, we will light up 6 Mile and it will thrive. The businesses, you know, are all working together. I see them as a unified community. I don't see blight. I don't see people being afraid. I see it well lit. I see it thriving even when it's dark outside.
Hi, welcome back. I'm joined now by some of the folks you saw in the video and some of the people who are doing the hard work in this neighborhood. Lauren Hood of the Live6 Alliance, Donald Jones of Detroit's New Economy Initiative, and Rhonda Morris of Lucki's Cheesecakes. And you seem to have forgotten the cheesecake, Ms. Morris.
I just got off from work. I really wasn't.
Maybe we can do a call-in order. You know, as Christy said in the opening, we spend a whole lot of time when we're talking about Detroit's revival, talking about downtown and Corktown and Midtown, some of the other places that get all the press, all the attention. Don, let me start with you. How is developing a neighborhood or redeveloping a neighborhood different from bringing back a downtown?
That's a great question, Nolan. That's really one of the focus of the New Economy Initiative. We look from grassroots to high growth, and the challenges in the neighborhoods is that they don't have all of the resources to get focused on big developments and the large developments that go on in the downtown. So our work is looking at organizations like Live6. We work with Prosperous in Southwest Detroit. We work with the Grandmont Rosedale CDC. We work with the Central Detroit Christian CDC. And what they do is they bring resources to the businesses that want to start in those neighborhoods. So what do they need? They need to understand what capital readiness is. What do they need to put their books together? What do they need for their marketing plans? And they don't have those resources because they're small businesses. So by working with those CDCs and bringing the skills that they need for those businesses, they can grow one at a time. Our second part is our Any Ideas, which is going on right now. And any business in the city of Detroit that's been around for 3 years can apply, get a $10,000 grant, and that can help them to grow their business. So actually, I brought one here for you. Are you ready? Go, apply.
So we're seeing a lot of private investment dollars flow into downtown. Yeah. Are we seeing a similar interest in the neighborhoods in terms of private capital?
Again, I think it's built upon assets. When they're seeing neighborhoods where there's opportunities to grow, again, like Live6, where they see that there's businesses that are starting to develop. So as density forms, then the private capital starts moving into those neighborhoods. They're starting to develop those businesses. So the Motor City Match is another great program. So they're seeing how they can revitalize commercial buildings. That leads to density, and so that brings in more developers that want to then grow those areas. It goes slowly, but it needs to go certainly, and that's how you're going to get the growth that's going to make a difference.
Ms. Hood, you're out here every day working hard. You're seeing the development in this area. You're seeing the growth. How frustrating is it for you not to hear about it when all the discussion is perhaps elsewhere in the city?
Well, I can't say that that's true, Nolan. I hear about it all the time, and I feel like I spend a good 50% of my time doing interviews and talking to press. Yeah. So I feel like the memo's gotten out. Everybody knows that things are about to happen here. And I'm okay with a little more of the tension being focused in other areas of the city, because I feel like we're trying to grow something here that's a little more organic. And for that to happen, it kind of needs to stay amongst the people that are here for a minute.
Well, your goal is to redevelop this neighborhood without changing its character. Mm-hmm. How is that possible? How is it possible to bring economic diversity to a neighborhood that's been distressed and development to a neighborhood that's been distressed without some sort of displacement and without changing the nature of the neighborhood?
Well, I think it's really simple. You just start by asking the people that are here, what do you want to see? What do you want to see? What don't you want to see? What's missing from the mix? I remember, where's Nancy at? Your mom, a longtime resident last night was telling me, oh, that on the corridor you used to have all the things that you needed, you never had to leave. So you could get your food, you could get your pantyhose, you could get your clothes, like everything you needed was right in the neighborhood and you didn't have to leave. So that has me thinking, you know what, we need some basic necessities here. Mm-hmm. On the surface, it might seem like we need a hot new restaurant. So there is some feedback like that. I think in some of the pop-ups that we've had, we bring together like people from the institutions and people from the neighborhood to come together, so it demonstrates that there's also a need for public space, gathering spaces for people to hang out, but maybe it's not that sexy new restaurant. Maybe it looks different up here. We don't know. We're figuring that out organically.
But that is a good point. I mean, the commercial strips in Detroit have long ago been emptied out in many neighborhoods, and so the basic businesses that people rely on in their communities are missing. I mean, if you had a wish list of the sort of businesses you want to come into the strips in this neighborhood, what would they be?
Well, it's not my wish list. Mm-hmm. It's a wish list that's assembled from the people that I've sure. spoken to here. But I think that people want healthy food options. People want some kind of exercise facility. People also want a gathering space. So what Giovanna's bringing is fantastic. I think that's going to have a huge impact on people being able to gather somewhere and get to know each other and break down some of the barriers between people.
Ms. Morris, you're operating a business here. What are the challenges you faced in getting started and in staying open in the city?
Well, when I first started, it was very hard for me because I didn't have anyone to show me or to help me, you know, tell me where to go for different things. And now I just made it where I think that I'm going to always help people who are trying to do something. I'm gonna give it my all.
Now, are your customer base, are you drawing it primarily from this neighborhood? Are there enough customers in this neighborhood to support your business, or do you have to reach further?
Well, I do a lot on the internet, mm-hmm. Word of mouth. I do a lot of restaurants, all the restaurants around the neighborhood, like I do Cuzzo's. I do all the pizza places, I do Fresh Fish House, and they're all in the neighborhood. So it really helps a lot.
Mr. Jones, when it comes to stabilizing a neighborhood, how important is a small business base?
Oh, we think and we know that it's absolutely important. As Lauren said, it's finding out what the people in the neighborhood want and then helping to build those businesses. You're talking about the lack of services and products that are now available. I think the numbers that we've seen is that the amount of money that actually leaves the city of Detroit, like $1.5 billion a year, drives out of the city to go buy services. So helping to build those businesses in the neighborhoods that are providing those basic services, those hardware stores, those coffee places, those gathering places, those basic services will make all the difference to helping those neighborhoods then get the density. They become walkable. They become the places that people want to be, become neighborhoods of choice.
If you look at this neighborhood, if you could pick the one thing that sort of sparked the revival here and the interest here and the development, can you point your finger at one thing?
That's tricky. I would probably say the people. So from what I know about this place, I grew up in one of the adjacent neighborhoods. The people that are here have been here 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, and their parents before them have been here. So it's kind of one of those places where I don't know, you just know that there's a sense of community here. People are connected, people are entrenched, nobody's going anywhere, they're invested, they own their homes, they're sticking around. I think that's something that, well, it exists in other parts of the city, but I think it's special here.
Ms. Morris, how long have you been in this neighborhood?
I've been here 5 years.
Okay, what have you seen in those 5 years in terms of a change, in terms of a difference?
Well, I see the people trying to make their homes much better, trying to clean up the neighborhood. They seem to be really happy that I am in the neighborhood, so they don't have to move out, they don't have to go any other place.
So they're supporting you?
Yes, they are.
And so conditions in the neighborhood, have they changed? Have you seen a correspondent benefit in your surrounding neighborhoods, the streets around your business?
I think so, I really do.
When you all look at the city, and you know, it's the city's development efforts are spread thin. You know, there are a lot of needs in a lot of different places. Are you all getting what you need in terms of help from downtown, help from City Hall?
Who's it for? I can take it. I would say so. Well, I feel like the city has what's almost a whole task force that works specifically on Livernois 6 Mile, so we get plenty from the city. Sometimes it's a little too much. but yeah, they're heavily involved. They're really engaged. They know all the neighbors that I know. They're out here doing the groundwork just like we are. So I think so.
Yeah, and from our point of view, philanthropy supports the work of the New Economy Initiative, 10 foundations that have come together. So we're in a great place that we can work with the city. We're trying to complement the work that they're thinking about. So we're seeing more and more opportunity. We're seeing more and more skills. We're seeing more and more people that are coming out of the city that are saying, here's our plan for neighborhood stable revitalization, whether it's in Southwest or in Jefferson East. This is what we want to do. Can you help us in terms of looking at the business development work that you can do with your philanthropic dollars that we're not able necessarily to do with state dollars or federal dollars or municipal dollars?
So what would it take to replicate this across Detroit in neighborhoods, east side, west side?
I think it's the mixture. It's first, as Lauren said, number one, getting each of those neighborhoods and finding out what the people want. Once you've decided what the people want, then it's sitting down with those people in the neighborhood and then bringing the resources that they need to bear. And it's going to be different. I think you said that earlier. It's going to be different in every single neighborhood. You've got to build upon the assets of every neighborhood. Here with the university is the asset here. If you're down in Southwest Detroit, there's a huge number of assets to build on there.
Okay. Thank you. And finally, best-selling cheesecake.
Right now, Superman.
Superman.
Yes.
Okay, we'll try that next. We're back to Christy.
Yeah, we need a sample of that cheesecake right here. You know, from the 1950s to the 70s, the strip of Livernois between 7 and 8 Mile roads was the place to go for shopping, dining, and a night out on the town. And the area earned the distinction of being called the Avenue of Fashion. It was the perfect example of an urban neighborhood with a thriving commercial district.
Particular neighborhoods. They have their own schools that would establish a neighborhood's identity, shopping districts, stores. A lot of it gets infused with nostalgia as well. So when people think nostalgically about the past, you know, trip down memory lane, they remember the shoe store they used to go to or the tailor they went to.
Detroit, when it was designed, its original footprint was to make neighborhoods almost self-sustaining. Almost like towns within towns.
The Avenue of Fashion is at as a human scale. It's low scale, small stores. It fits in tightly with the neighborhood around it.
I feel like it used to mean something to be able to shop in your neighborhood and buy things from people that you would know.
I think that it came about because there was this really strong middle and upper middle class neighborhood, Sherwood Forest, and the area on the other side of Livernois. To the east of Livernois was Sherwood Forest, but to the west of Livernois was very solid housing stock. There were people here who had income, and there were surrounding neighborhoods that this was an accessible shopping area for. So they made it into this kind of exclusive area.
It was the place to be. A lot of Detroit's elite and power players, if you will, shopped the area. It was famous for having specialty stores, people like Grinnell's, B. Spiegel's.
It had a defined character, and it did speak exclusivity in some ways.
It was one of the first places that Black people had wealth, so we were very conscious of keeping it in the community at that time. I feel like it used to mean something to be able to shop in your neighborhood and buy things from people that you would know, but it's different now. Now there's like this sense of emergency, so looking at all the new development that's happening in the city, people are noticing that a lot of it is happening downtown, in Midtown, in Corktown, and people are like, oh my God, we have to help the neighborhoods.
I guess in some ways you're looking at what's happening at the Avenue Fashion House, sort of an experiment, a live experiment, that with sufficient attention and care and careful planning, what you're looking for is to create some sustainable development, right? I mean, what will do that?
It starts with family. And what I mean by that is that when families get stronger, neighborhoods get stronger, and communities get stronger. So it's almost starting at the root.
Most of the people that live in this neighborhood have lived here for 20, 30, 40, 50 years. It's not a transient place. It's a place where people have roots. Generations of families live here. They pass the houses down to their children, and the children want to stay in those houses.
Myself and my two nephews has been working for about 3 or 4 years in developing the whole Cuzzo project. And my nephew, getting him to come back home was big for me, and it was big for the family. The goal is to build from 8 Mile to the Lodge and have it take off from there. And then act as a recruiter, recruit other businesses to make it happen faster. And then just simply begin to duplicate this in other parts of the city. The only way you're gonna change something is to invest in it. You can't talk something up. And so at one point, you gotta put your money and your effort and your resources where your thoughts and visions are. And so if you wanna change condition of anything, not only Detroit or any other place, you gotta dig in and you gotta put something in it.
You know, business owners and residents are perhaps the biggest cheerleaders for reinventing the avenue of fashion. They're eager to transform it into the thriving community that it once was. And joining me now is Kim Tandy, who grew up in the area. She still lives here, and she serves as the District 2 Manager in Detroit's Department of Neighborhoods. Kim, thanks so much for joining me. I appreciate it.
Absolutely.
You know, when I read this intro and I say things like transform and reinventing, do you think those are the words that we should use when we talk about this area? Are those the right words to use?
I think so. I think that, you know, we're bringing back something. I grew up in the neighborhood. I was born here, and I still live here. And so I remember Wendy Siegel's and those other stores that were just talked about. I remember those places. And I remember the excitement that was on Livernois. So I think we are bringing that back. So we're reinventing that. I hope that we're reinventing it in a 2017, 2018, 3,000 way, so that we're not, you know, going backwards, but we are moving forward. And I think we are reinventing some of it. Some of it has been here and has not gone away. I think one of the biggest assets of this area and of the city, and especially the surrounding area, is that there has been so much that has been stable for so long. This is not something that's new. We had it, we lost a little bit of it, we got it back, we lost a little bit of it, and you know, now we're trying to really bring it back with a boom, with all the support and the collaboration of all the people that are working together to get it.
All right, so how do you reinvent or do it in the 2017, 3000 way where you're bringing it into the future, but you're maintaining a cultural heritage to this area, or you're not making people who have been here for 30, 40 years feel like they don't belong in this area anymore because now it's transformed or reinvented?
So I think that, you know, one of the mayor's incentives, you know, when he was running for mayor, was that we've got to bring these neighborhoods back and really talk up to the neighborhoods and have the neighborhoods have some input in how that happens. Mm-hmm. So that it's not from downtown, it's not from midtown, it's actually from the city and from the neighborhoods. So I think that, you know, what's been discussed earlier is that, you know, we need to talk to the neighbors. And our neighborhoods, the biggest asset we have in this community are the people. These are people that have lived here for years and years and generations. And so as you talk to them, as you keep engaging them, they've been engaged. They work on Livernois. They come and support Livernois. They want more. They remember when. And so I think that the biggest thing is going to be in the asset is going to be the people.
All right, so in your role then, working with the city and working in this district area, what are some of the top things that people are telling you?
Well, one is that we've got to, you know, Livernois didn't happen and fall apart because it was a Detroit thing. It happened, you know, we were the first city to have an enclosed mall. When Northland happened, every place around the country, people started going to malls. So it didn't fall apart here, but we still had the people that were here that wanted to shop and do some things locally also. So I think that in those conversations and in keeping and working with the people that are here, they kept some of these alive. We didn't lose it totally. Livernois never kind of died away. The building, the infrastructure was still here. So we need to get rid of the blight and some of the things that have happened and then reinvent again some of those stores and some of those places, re-engage the people that have been engaged, that kind of lost a little hope for a little while and kind of felt beat down because it wasn't going in the direction that they want, and re-engage that, get that excitement going. I think that we have a fantastic new city planner that has that kind of concept and understands how community gets involved. And so in working with the city and working with a mayor who really believes in the city and the people that were here so that we don't lose them, we keep having those conversations.
So do other parts of the city, I mean, in other districts, do they say, okay, we're gonna look at what you're doing here and we can model it
someplace else, or is it just so unique what's here that what you're doing, it can't transfer anywhere else in the city? Or how do you help out other areas of the city to say, hey, this is what we're doing and this is working?
I think that, you know, one of the things that we're doing is you start for a small area, you really make it happen. I think that once you make things happen, people get on board and they get excited about it, and then you can use it. It will never be, I don't believe that you like take a Chicago and move it to Detroit. You know, because it's a different place. There are different people. So I don't think you're going to take Livernois and 7 Mile and move it to Warren. But I think the concept and the procedure of how you get people involved and get what needs to be going in those neighborhoods can be what's developed. So we develop the process, and then we develop a neighborhood, and then we take that process to another area of the city and then develop that neighborhood in its own identity in its own way.
All right, so on the flip side of that, is there anything from, like, say, the Midtown model that you look and see what they've done there and say, well, we're going to cherry pick a little bit of what they've done and try to see if it works here?
I think the Midtown area is that you had a champion that was down in Midtown that has been working in Midtown, Sue Mosley, who was working there for many, many, many years without any publicity, without any help, without any things. She was a champion that was there that worked through some of these things and worked her process. And she created her process. And then finally, when she got her process and things were going and she got the recognition, then everybody marketed and that's where people wanted to go. I think that we use that kind of a model, knowing that we take the people that are here, again, and that's so, that process of taking people, engaging them, and then when it's time, you know, Lauren said, sometimes we have to be quiet for a little while before the storm happens. Sometimes we need our people and everybody to kind of get our arms around each other, talk about what needs to happen, and then the process happens, and then we could publicize it and work through it, and I think that's kind of what happened in Midtown, and I'm sure it's going to happen on Livernois and 6 Mile, 7 Mile, all the way to 8 Mile.
All right, so we've talked about, we've said probably a couple times tonight, what's the past 5 years been like? I'm going to ask you to take me 5 years into the future and what you want to see for this area.
I see a extremely, extremely prosperous Livernois. I see an extremely prosperous 7 Mile. I see different kinds of prosperous on Puritan and Wyoming. I see all of our neighborhoods having a purpose for every lot that's in that neighborhood, whether or not it's a vacant lot that somebody adopts, whether or not it's a vacant lot that the city adopts, whether or not it's a house that's currently vacant becomes occupied, whether or not it's a current house, the owner that's been there for a very long time, feeling a part of a new process and reinvigorating their own lots. I think that every lot over here will have a purpose, and I think that's the mayor's incentives, that we have a purpose for every place, and that the quality of life for everybody that has lived here for many, many years can continue to have, and those that want to join us can come in and enjoy also.
Well, Kim, Tandy, thanks for joining us, and keep us posted on the progress. We
Absolutely.
Want to see it. All
right, and I don't think it's going to take 5 years.
All right, well, we're going to hold you to that. All right, well, you know, Stephen Henderson grew up just a couple of miles south of Detroit Mercy on Tuxedo Street, and he's taken on the ambitious task of restoring his childhood home that now sits abandoned and ransacked. Well, this week, Stephen and I paid a visit to his old neighborhood. Take a look.
Yeah.
Remember my mom, Elaine?
I remember your mother. I remember you when you was a baby. Yeah. I remember your daddy real.
Yeah.
So tell me where we're standing right now.
We're standing at the steps of the house where my family lived when I was born in 1970. Of course, it looked a lot different then than it does now, but that's what's brought me back here, is the idea that it's sitting here, it's empty, it's deteriorating, and I'm afraid it'll go away unless I do something to stop that from happening, and so I've decided that I will.
When you look at this, what goes through your mind?
It's very difficult. It's very difficult to look at it. It's hard to see it like this. It's certainly hard to go inside and sort of bring back all the memories that I have of being a kid here and sort of growing up here with my dad. He lived here until he died in the mid-1980s. It's nothing like what I can remember, and it's a reminder of the way the city has changed over that time. Lots and lots of places look like this.
Give me an idea of what some of those memories are, what this neighborhood was like when you were coming here as a kid.
Yeah, well, for starters, there are a lot more people around. All of these houses were occupied, mostly full of families, so you'd see children outside, you'd see adults milling around. Now, 13 of the houses on this block are empty, including this one, so almost half the block, and there are a lot fewer people around. I mean, it just, it feels different, it looks different, and it's got all of these challenges wrapped up in the properties that are deteriorating.
Yeah, it's interesting, because I think when people say, oh, abandoned homes in Detroit, and you drive by, and there are Christmas lights on this house.
Yeah.
And, which, you know, I think you never stop to think about people who were here beforehand.
Yeah, those are from Christmas 2011. I remember when they were on, when I came by that season, and then early 2012 was when it went empty, and they just never took the lights down. And so I've taken a bunch of pictures of the house, and I've taken lots of pictures of those Christmas lights, because I think they're a reminder of the life that was in here.
People would say, oh, come on now, Stephen. I mean, can you really make a difference
here? You aren't
here?
The only person saying
well,
that.
I mean, it's a question that you look at this and you say, gosh, this is beyond. Why don't you just walk away from this and find some other project?
Yeah, well, I mean, that was my instinct at first, was I don't own it. I don't live here. It's really not, it doesn't have to be my problem. But I really decided that that it's possible to do something about this house. I came up with an idea for it, found funding for it, and now we've raised enough money that we think we can do something with all of the empty properties on the block. And that's the real challenge in Detroit.
And Stephen has written about this project in freep.com. You should check it out. He's working with Mary Grove College on this project, and the home is going to be transformed into a writer's residence and a literary center. And we know, Stephen, that you're going to keep us posted on this progress. So let's head on over to you right now.
All right. Thank you very much, Christy. I'm joined now by Maurice Cox, who's the planning director for the City of Detroit, Gaston Nash of the College Core Block Club, and Dan Patera of the Detroit Collaborative Design Center. Welcome to MiWeek. Maurice, I want to start with you. The neighborhood where I was just out in front of the house where I was born, it's only a few miles from here in the Live6 community. Really different story, though. A lot more abandonment, a lot tougher challenges, and the city has not reached the point where it can decide what should happen to places like that yet. What do you say to people who live in neighborhoods like that about the changes that they might see in neighborhoods around them?
Well,
when is their turn, I think,
well,
is the question
I would
ask.
Say to them, hold on, we're coming. The city has finally turned its attention to the neighborhoods. So if you think of the heart of any city, you think of its downtown. But if you think of the soul of a city, you think about its neighborhoods. And so the heart of the city is well, it's thriving. Now it's time for us to turn our full attention to the soul of the city, so neighborhoods. So when you look at where to start, because we have so many neighborhoods, you look for a neighborhood that has a particular set of assets that you can build from. A lot has been talked about the people, but another aspect of the Livernois-McNichols area is that it has these anchor institutions, UDM and Marygrove. Not a lot of neighborhoods have such strong anchors, and they lie right in the middle of an area that we've targeted. It's a quarter square mile, it's 160 acres, that we think that we can make whole again, in large part because of these anchor institutions. But it involves a complete, comprehensive strategy, every tool in our toolbox, which we expect to deploy to bring that neighborhood back.
But in neighborhoods that don't have those anchor institutions, that don't have the population density, like Tuxedo and Livernois, what's the answer?
Well, I think we have to start from our strengths. We have some neighborhoods that have really stayed vibrant and alive. There are signs of decline or vacancy, but we can turn that around. There are other neighborhoods that we can stabilize through strategies of just adaptive reuse, rehabbing houses, planting so that the vacancy is contributing somehow by creating new landscapes. So I think for every neighborhood, whether it's a strong market or a flat market or a weak market, we have to have a different set of strategies. But the component parts, I would contend, are very, very similar.
Gaston Nash, tell me about the College Core Block Club.
College Core started as a partnership with University of Detroit Mercy Masters of Community Development students. They were doing a capstone in our area, and I had just purchased a house there not too long before that, and we kind of ran into each other, and from that came the block club.
Yeah, and talk about the sort of building of community that you've sort of built on that.
So once we started the block club, the block club actually started with two people, me and another neighbor on my street, and we just started going door to door, speaking with folks, you know, just getting to know the neighborhood, well, I was getting to know the neighborhood. I had just moved there. My neighbor.
Talk about which neighborhood this was.
This is the area between U of D and Marygrove College.
Yeah.
So, you know, we just went door to door, just meeting everybody, and it was a long process. But now we kind of know everybody.
Yeah,
and
it's harder than most people would think to start a block club in a place where there isn't one. And it's not that people don't want to be involved or don't care about the neighborhood. It's that that kind of organization is just not something that they're used to, right?
Well, I mean, I think exactly. Everybody cares, but you know, it takes that person or people, those people, to, you know, actually, you know, step out on a limb and make the first step to make things happen. I'm pretty sure there were block clubs there before, but you know, if people are beaten down, then. And they don't see anything happen, it's hard.
Yeah. Dan Patera, what do you guys see when you look at neighborhoods like Live6 versus neighborhoods like Tuxedo and Livernois, that gap between the two?
I see connections between them as opposed to seeing the neighborhoods individually, which we oftentimes do in the city. We say this neighborhood and this neighborhood. I see them actually connected together. They still can have their individual identity, but when you think about a neighborhood that has what we keep saying, a lot of abandonment, and look at it as land that has opportunity next to a neighborhood that has more people and maybe less land, if we thought about them together, then all of a sudden maybe it's a different dialogue that we're having, that they can, so it's not like the area around Tuxedo has to change its name. No, it can still have identity, but now it's connected with and connected to the assets of other neighborhoods. And so they build together.
So how would that look? How would that look for people on Tuxedo, for instance?
So building a little bit on what Maurice Cox was saying, that when you have some land, that land could be used in a productive way. It could be used to clean our water. It could be used to generate energy. It could be used for, as we've seen in a lot of neighborhoods already, to generate food. Things like that, where other neighborhoods would love to have that opportunity, but don't have that land for that.
Yeah.
So, and that being right next to a place where there are people, more people, I should say, that then together they can, that asset can be combined with the other assets.
Yeah. Maurice, the mayor, has this saying, every neighborhood has a future. And he's gotten in trouble sometimes for saying that, because I think a lot of people see neighborhoods or live in neighborhoods where they think, well, future is.
Mm-hmm.
But when you say that, you're not necessarily saying that every neighborhood has the same future. I think that's one of the important distinctions. You're saying that there is a future for every neighborhood, and the future for a neighborhood like Tuxedo might look different in terms of land use and density than someplace like Livernois and McNichols.
I believe in that slogan, every neighborhood has a future. I think every neighborhood has assets. If you think a little bit about the Detroit neighborhoods, they all have streets, they all have historic homes, they all have sidewalks, they all have the presence of nature, they all have a commercial corridor that's easily a 20-minute walk from your door.
Mm-hmm.
So I've started talking about the common traits of Detroit's neighborhoods. They all have these traits. So some may be more populated, some may be less populated, but if you try to think about what would make a neighborhood, a Detroit neighborhood, truly competitive against our friends in the suburbs, well, you know, we have the longevity of history. We have gorgeous homes throughout these neighborhoods. We have main streets that are walkable. We have the presence of nature. Some of these streets are lined with mature trees. And I think that we can use those components to produce a competitive advantage for Detroit neighborhoods. So imagine if we could create a blight-free quarter square mile. we're going to do that in the Fitzgerald neighborhood. Imagine if we went into a neighborhood and rehabbed every single house there and restored those beautiful homes to their splendor. Imagine if every single vacant lot was greened. It had a purpose, that it actually created physical beauty when you went on your walk in your neighborhood. That's not a pipe dream. That is like 12 months from now. We are going to see that in one of our neighborhoods, and then we're going to look.
That becomes
the model. And then if we can produce that, and that's without building a single new single family home. If we can regenerate the neighborhood without the traditional crutches of development as we know it, I think we will have solved problems for many, many, many of the neighborhoods of Detroit.
Yeah. Gaston, one of the things that when you guys talk in your block club, that you imagine for your neighborhood in the next 3 or 5 years?
Well, we're looking at each lot to kind of give it a purpose. I think, you know, lots that are directly next to neighbors, if you look at our neighborhood, it's not too far from what Tuxedo looks like, some of it. So, you know, you have house, lot, you know, maybe some of those owners of those houses could connect that lot to their house.
And take care of them.
Yeah, now you have a suburban type deal with your home, you know. So, things like putting basketball courts, if you go up and down the streets, you see basketball courts on every, or basketball hoops on every street. What if you had that on the lot?
Right.
And kids could walk down to the park and play basketball or things like that.
Yeah. Dan, when we look at neighborhoods in the city, I think a lot of people think it's just overwhelming. There's so much. There's so much to do. What tells you that it's doable, that we can win?
The work that we're talking about right here, and seeing, we work all over the city, and seeing the efforts that have been going on from a variety of different, whether it's individuals, whether it's block clubs, whether it's organizations, that's the hope. And it's wonderful that we're focusing on this area and we're talking about this area, but I think we can begin to look at another area and of another area and say, so we can see what's happening there, we can see what's happening there. And it's really seeing people, Detroiters, doing a difference. And it sounds like a slogan to say that way, but they really are doing that difference from all at all scales.
Okay. All right, guys, thanks very much for being here. Back to you, Christy.
All right, Stephen, you know, as we've heard tonight, the future of Detroit neighborhoods really depends upon economic development and population growth. New businesses must blend with older establishments, and so must longtime residents and newcomers. Well, we took our cameras to a recent block party to hear what people thought about the changing neighborhoods. Take a look.
It's definitely changing. Lost a lot of people as far as population. But the people that are still here, still together, still strong, so it's a cool place.
I can't say I see a lot of new people, but I do see a lot of interest riding through the neighborhoods, wanting to see a change. So hopefully our company, as well as the people that are interested, can make a positive influence on the Detroit neighborhoods.
The new businesses that are really successful are owned by people that are from here. So it's not like an outsiders are coming in, it's just like insiders finally came up.
Obviously, everything that's going on in Detroit is great, but that connection to the neighborhoods, and I think this beachhead here at 6th and Livernois starts to create more connection points. And we have a long way to go, but as someone who, you know, grew up in Detroit in the 70s and kind of an idyllic growing up, I'm really excited about what we're seeing.
In my experience thus far has been very warm. I really feel that the people who live here, the older generation of folks who live in this neighborhood, are very welcoming of new energy, new blood. And so it's really exciting to be a part of this project. It's really exciting to contribute to it. And the most exciting part is when you feel that you're wanted, when you feel that the people here in the community want you here, that you're welcome.
All right, you know, as we kind of wrap things up a little bit, and Nolan, just give me your final thoughts here on what we've had a discussion on.
Well, it's interesting to see how excited and enthused people are about bringing back this neighborhood, and it was interesting to talk to the folks about the various pieces that are needed to restore a neighborhood. Business community and a strong business base, certainly important. We didn't talk much about education. I know we're going to do that on future shows. But, I mean, that's an element, too, we've got to get to. Adding the schools, adding quality schools and neighborhoods so they become a true holistic place where people can live and raise families.
You know, one thing that I picked up that Lauren was talking about was the thing that this has to be an organic process right. as well, and that you have to involve people and you have to make sure that they feel that they have a vested stake in this, that it's not happening somewhere in a small room and then it's the dictated plan for what this place is going to be.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think a lot of people in neighborhoods are sitting and waiting for their turn in that way to be able to say, we've been here a long time, we've seen this place deteriorate, and we have ideas about, you know, what should happen next or how to fix what the problems right. are, and we need investment and resources to be able to do it. That's the real trick. They're not going to be able to do it on their own.
All right, well, thanks, guys. This was a lot of fun being out on the road and live at the University of Detroit Mercy. Thank you so much for being with us tonight. That's going to do it for our special live broadcast of MiWeek. Thanks for joining us. We're going to continue our conversation now live online at MiWeek.org. So you're going to hear about after the show there. We're going to hear more from our guests, take some questions from the audience. And as always, you can find us during the week on Facebook and on Twitter at MiWeek. For all of us at Detroit Public Television, I'm Christy McDonald. We will see you next time for MiWeek. Take care. Thanks so much, guys. We appreciate it.
From the moment you wake up till you turn out the light, Masco is proud to be part of your everyday life. When you turn on the faucet for a cool drink of water, open a kitchen cabinet to set the family table, or freshen up a room with a new coat of paint. You do it all with Masco products. Masco and its family of companies, serving Michigan communities since 1929.
Did you know? Roush Enterprises was selected by Google to assemble a test fleet of 100 prototype self-driving cars in 2015. It also produced the new Domino's delivery cars. And speaking of Domino's, Domino's sells well over 2 million pizzas per day around the world, and half of their sales are digital. These are just some of the ways Michigan's pioneers started out as small companies with big ideas.
We are business leaders for Michigan. We are committed to making Michigan a top 10 state for jobs, personal income, and a healthy economy. Funding is also provided by Delta.